Selection of a material in a machine component is decided by the property of that particular material. In this lecture, we will discuss about various properties which are used in mechanical engineering. So, most of the properties that we commonly use are obtained from what is known as a tensile test. Okay, in this tensile test, we have a specimen which is known as dog bone specimen, which whose dimensions are fixed provided by a ASTM standard or any other standard. Here we in the UTM machine we apply a load gradually from zero to the maximum value. So we are pulling it aside by applying some load. So initially, before the startup experiment, we measure the L0, that is initial length between two points. These are called gauge points. The distance between them is gauge mark. For example, it could be some 50 mm. And then the load is gradually applied. As the load is applied, the length of the specimen increases. So at each instant, whenever a load is increased, the corresponding change in length is also noted down. So now we can find out the strain using this formula, L minus L0 by L0, where L0 is initial length and L is the instant at which we are measuring the length. Similarly, at each point, we can measure the load applied. Initially it was zero, gradually you are increasing the load. So at each state, whenever you are increasing the load, you measure the load divided by the cross-section area, that is initial area, you will get the stress. So the stress and strain so calculated are called as engineering stress and engineering strain, because we are using initial length as well as the initial cross-sectional area. Okay, when we plot this in a graph, that is if you take the stress on the y-axis and strain in the x-axis, we get a curve like this. So on this curve we can define so many properties. Let's take the first one, proportional limit. Proportional limit is a point on the stress strain curve where it deviates from the straight line. Okay, if you look at this diagram, so this point is proportional limit. So up to this point, from zero, this point to this, it is a straight line. Beyond this, it is becoming curved line, or what is known as non-linear curve. So the point up to which the stress strain curve is linear is called proportional limit. And after proportional limit, at a short distance away, we will get what is known as elastic limit. So elastic limit is basically a limit up to which the stress and strain are elastic. Basically, it means if you remove the load, the deformation will come back to its original position. So most of the time, these two are not differentiable. Most of the time, they are commonly called as elastic limit is same as proportional limit. However, there is a minor difference between them. So as I said, elastic limit, the deformations are not permanent. So when you remove the load, they'll come back to their original position. So we define one more important property called modulus of elasticity. It is defined as the ratio of stress by strain. So as we said sigma y-axis and epsilon is an x-axis. If you take the curve and measure the slope, that is if you measure the dy by dx, okay, the value of that slope is called Young's modulus. This defines the stiffness of the material. Now we'll go to the tensile strength. Tensile strength is the peak of the stress strain curve is considered as tensile strength or ultimate strength. So if you go back to this, so this point, at this point where it's the maximum, we call it as ultimate tensile strength, and the stress at which it fails, okay, the stress is called fracture strength. And let us define yield point also. Here yield point is a point up to which material is not yielding. Basically what happens at this point, yield point, when you apply load is constant, but you are not increasing any load, but however you will find the material starts deforming, the length of the specimen increases, even though of course load is very much there, but you are not increasing the load. Without increasing the load, material changes its length, the specimen increases its length on its own. And this behavior is called yielding. The stress value at which this occurs is called as yield point. So the ductility is the ability to deform. So how best the material can be deformed is measured by a quantity called ductility. It's a general definition. The more specifically, we measure ductility using two parameters. One is percent elongation, another one is percent reduction in area. as you can see in the specimen, if there is a specimen of initial size, so as you stretch, the length increases, length of the specimen increases, whereas the diameter decreases. So ductility is measured by how much is the increase in length or how much is the decrease in the diameter or the area. So therefore, the first definition, percentage elongation, is measured as final length minus initial length divided by initial length. Okay. So into 100, of course, if you want percentage, you will measure multiply with 100. So you for steel, it will be anywhere between 20 to 30%, and it, for aluminium, it can be anywhere between 1 to 45%, depending on the other compositions of the alloy. In the similar fashion, we define percentage reduction in area. So initial area minus final area divided by initial area. So please look at the definition carefully. Here I'm using the first term as L1. L1 is your final length. Final length is always greater than the initial length. So L1 minus L0 will always be a positive value. Whereas when it comes to diameter, there is a decrease. So first cross-section area or first initial area is always greater than the final area. Therefore, A0 comes in the beginning. So that the both quantities, percentage elongation and percentage reduction in area, are positive quantities. Now, let us define a quantity called resilience. So it's similar to the English meaning of resilience. It is ability of the material to absorb energy when it is deformed elastically and release that energy upon unloading. So resilience represents the ability of the material to absorb that energy and release when required. More specifically, it is measured in terms of modulus of resilience. So modulus of resilience is nothing but before that we have to define what is known as strain energy. Strain energy is nothing but energy, that is elastic energy, divided by volume is your strain energy. So strain energy is given by this equation. It's actually measured as half into stress into strain. So this is strain energy density. So SED is strain energy density, is elastic energy divided by volume. So now with the knowledge of strain energy density, we will define what is known as modulus of resilience. It is the strain energy stored per unit volume when the material is stressed from zero stress to yield point stress. So if you apply load from zero value to yield point stress, so there is some work done by the external force. So that work done is stored in the system, in the specimen, as elastic energy. If you measure that elastic energy, okay, divide by that volume of the specimen, then you get what is known as modulus of resilience. So this is nothing but strain energy density when the material is at the yield point. Okay, in the similar fashion, we'll define what is known as toughness. Toughness is defined as, or it refers to, the ability of the material to absorb energy without fracturing. Okay, so it is measured as the, let's come back to the modulus of resilience. It is nothing but the area under stress strain curve up to the yield point. Similarly, the modulus of toughness is measured as area of the stress strain curve up to rupture. So both are similar. Okay, they are nothing but energy divided by volume. Only difference is, if the energy that you are using is up to the yield point, you call it as modulus of resilience. If you are using energy stored in the material up to rupture or up to fracture, we call it as modulus of toughness. So basically, their strain energy densities are different locations. The first one is up to yield point, second one is up to fracture or rupture.